The non-stimulants. So often when you think about non-stimulants, you think about amoxicillin and the newer agent, viloxazine. But we also include anything that doesn't affect dopamine in the nucleus accumbens. The alpha-2 agonists, the ER versions of each are approved. The non-ER versions are not approved. And then you have off-label. There's one at the bottom now that has a positive adult trial with a substantial effect size. It's not approved, although the agent is on the market. And hopefully the company, having gotten this signal from the published study, will go after an ADHD indication. I do think that we need more options here beyond the stimulants, although the stimulants are very helpful. They're not doing it for everybody. You all know how these agents work, except for the 33% who said they didn't know. For those people, let me tell you, atomoxetine affects norepinephrine by increasing norepinephrine, prefrontal cortex. Also, your reuptake proteins in the prefrontal cortex, when you talk about dopamine and norepinephrine going up in the prefrontal cortex, dopamine goes up because the NAT receptor is not specific for norepinephrine. Guanfacine and clonidine are alpha-2A agonists, and then they affect downstream dopamine. Viloxazine also is a norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor with some serotonin effects, and I'll show you that in a moment. Atomoxetine approved in 2002. It took 20 years to come up with another non-stimulant. 20 years. It just goes to how it goes to show you how difficult it is to come up with agents that have an effect on ADHD. And with all due respect to my colleagues who talk about neurotransmitters and neurocircuits, it is important to keep in mind that that's very interesting. It is the advancement of science, it's the advancement of research, and hopefully something will come out of that. But the pharmacologic cemetery is littered with phase two drugs that never got through phase three. So just try to be a little thoughtful and critical when you're listening to information about studies, because you ultimately want to decide on the clinical utility. And it may be nice that it's pharmacoprobable, but it doesn't necessarily translate into clinical utility. When would you prescribe a non-stimulant? You can answer this as well as I can. If the patient isn't responding to a stimulant, they can't tolerate the stimulant, you've walked through two or three of them, you consider a non-stimulant. You might consider a non-stimulant if they're on a stimulant medication, but executive function or social anxiety becomes a problem because atomoxetine has trials that show benefit for both executive function and social anxiety. So that's where you might use it adjunctively. You might use it as a primary agent for somebody that you have concern is substance abuse, or somebody who you're concerned is trying to game the system and fake the ADHD evaluation. And so you know this when I say, perhaps we'll start with a non-stimulant. They say, no, I want that little blue pill. I say, Viagra? They say, no, Adderall, Dr. Goodman. And I say, well, let's talk about the options. The more they push back on getting a non-stimulant when you're suspicious of drug abuse, the more likely they're telling you they're drug-seeking and not treatment-seeking. Also, non-stimulants are non-abusable. What's the definition of an abuse drug? Something that increases dopamine levels in the nucleus accumbens. These agents don't do that. FDA approval for non-stimulants, you know atomoxetine and viloxazine are the only two. And then there are investigational drugs. Because my interest is in adult ADHD and older adults over the age of 50, it's interesting to look at the age limits on these trials, 55, 65. And I can tell you that the number of adults in these clinical trials over the age of 45, not very high. So if you're using these medications, whether it's stimulants or non-stimulants, in patients over the age of 60 or 65, you're using them off-label. You can simply document that. There was a time when Medicare wasn't approving these. They've gotten a lot more liberal on that. But just so you understand, this is one of these desktop slides. I'm not going to walk through this, but it's a good comparison of the non-stimulant agents, the four, On the drug side, the common side effects, something I'll highlight here is that for children, atomoxetine has a weight-based dosing. So for the children and adolescents under 60 milligrams, under 60 kilograms, 70 kilograms, you have weight-based dosing, and after that, it's not necessarily weight-based dosing. For viloxazine ER, children and then adolescents and then adults, you're going higher up on the dosing. Guanfacine ER and clonidine ER, again, approved for children and adolescents, not approved for adults, commonly used by people in the ADHD field. There's a Japanese RCT that shows it's positive in adult ADHD. Because it doesn't have a commercial viability, you're not going to see companies going after an indication for these medications.